I'm glad to see so many of you here so early. We have such a full day, we decided we'd better take a chance on beginning at 9 o'clock. And I'm so happy that so many of you have taken up the challenge. We've got a wonderful program, and I think it will be a very stimulating day. And I'm grateful to our new dean, who's completing his first year, Dean Trevor Morrison, who is something of an East Asian expert himself because of his work on Japan, Japanese history, and related subjects. And he's been a great supporter to the work of our East Asian program, our U.S. Asia Law Institute, and to the Bernstein program. And I want to welcome, of course, our distinguished alumna, Sharon Ham, who leads human rights in China under the guidance of Professor Fu Hualing and our own Bill Bernstein. This is a distinguished collaboration. I think we brought together a stimulating group from Asia as well as the United States and Europe, and I wish you all a very good day. And now it's my pleasure to ask Dean Morrison to lead off.
Thanks, Jerry, and welcome. Good morning, everyone. It's a delight for me to be able to welcome all of you to the 2014 Bernstein China Symposium on Promoting Human Rights in China, which is presented by our U.S. Asia Law Institute here at NYU Law School, along with and in partnership with Human Rights in China. I want to start by thanking our terrific roster of speakers, panelists, and moderators today. You will see over the course of the day what a distinguished group of speakers we have really from around the world. So thank you all very much for sharing your expertise and insight and for traveling to be with us today. The goal of the day, as I understand it, is to promote dialogue, a critical dialogue on issues influencing the reform of human rights in China. From a variety of vantage points, including how and whether and how domestic policy and Chinese civil society interrelate with the promotion of human rights in China, and what role the international community can, should, does play in the reform process. I want to say a few obvious things, including that today would simply not be possible without the work of both our partner Human Rights in China and our own U.S. Asia Law Institute. We are thrilled to be joining forces with HRIC, and I just want to take a moment to celebrate just how influential our own U.S. Asia Law Institute is, both to our local and our more global communities. The U.S. Asia Law Institute is really the law school's portal to Asia. It works directly with counterparts in China on legal reform, provides educational opportunities concerning the Asian legal systems, advises policymakers and international bodies, and raises public awareness of legal developments and challenges in Asia. It's currently working on really an astonishing array of very important projects, including on criminal justice reform in China, on supporting public interest law in China, including advocacy for labor rights, land rights, and combating discrimination. They're slated to undertake another project that will promote the protection of Chinese lawyers through professional responsibility training. And this is on the heels of completing two long-term projects on death penalty reform in China, all incredibly important and significant work. In addition to its global scope, the Institute informs our more immediate community here on the square, that is Washington Square, by sponsoring the teaching of courses on Chinese law, perspectives on Chinese criminal justice, Asian legal systems, law, and development. And to enable students to use what they've learned on this front, we are truly honored to have the Robert L. Bernstein Fellowship in International Human Rights, which enables NYU Law School graduates to devote a year to full-time human rights work at Human Rights in China. This is the focal point of our partnership with that institution, and I really couldn't be more pleased than to see it flourishing in the way that it is. The U.S. Asia Law Institute has excelled thanks in substantial part to its spectacular leadership. That includes, of course, Jerry Cohen, known throughout the world and in this institution for his singular influence in this area and so many others. And in addition, Frank Upham is another faculty director of the U.S. Asia Law Institute, as well as our Wilf Family Professor of Property Law. And he's also the faculty director of our new study abroad program in Shanghai, which is having its first semester right now. And finally, I want to recognize and thank our own graduate, Ira Belkin, the executive director of the Institute. Ira is doing tremendous work on behalf of the Institute and the law school more generally, as well as doing things like squiring me around China on my first trip there in January, and doing a terrific job at that as well. So thank you, Ira. I am thrilled, in closing, that the Bernstein China Symposium gives us a chance to promote what I know will be a terrific day of dialogue and to highlight the ongoing excellent work of our U.S. Asia Law Institute in partnership with human rights and China. And so without further ado, I will get out of the way of this excellent agenda and welcome Ira as moderator and the other panelists for the first panel. Thank you all for being here.
Good morning, everybody. Zao shang hao. I want to thank Professor Cohen and Dean Morrison for those introductory remarks. I can now throw away my commercial for the U.S. Asia Law Institute. So I really appreciate the support from Dean Morrison. Within his first 6 months, he traveled to China with us. We went had a great series of meetings, including a meeting with the President of the Supreme People's Court, Zhou Qiang. NYU's involvement with China is very deep and very broad, and today's conference is part of it. Very excited and pleased to be here and to moderate this first panel. We're very honored to co-host this event with Human Rights in China with Sharon Hahn and her excellent team. And we're fortunate to have our own amazing staff, Melissa Lefkowitz and Judy Joe especially, helping to organize this, as well as Casey O'Connor and Amanda Brown-Inns from Human Rights in China. So thank you for all your hard work over the many months leading up to this. We're incredibly fortunate to have a slate of speakers from who literally come from all over the world who have been focusing their research and their work on China and human rights and human rights-related issues for many, many years. One of the things that our panelists have in common is that they each have very deep on-the-ground experience in China. I won't go into the details of their bios. They're all on our website. But it's just kind of amazing. Professor Balme from Sciences Po in Paris has spent many years in China, not just studying Chinese law and judicial reform, but actually visiting local courts and living with judges on local courts for weeks at a time and learning how they work on a day-to-day basis. Eva Pills, Professor Pills from Hong Kong, who's a German-trained lawyer, but worked in China for many, many years and teaches in Hong Kong, perhaps has the broadest and deepest network of contacts among the human rights defender and human rights lawyer community in China, and knows them extremely well. And knows their situation, not from reading about them, but from talking to them and engaging with them and maintaining contact with them. Professor Fu Hualing, also from Hong Kong, grew up in the countryside in Hunan province, but was educated in China and Canada, and has written on virtually every subject of importance to human rights in China and the rule of law and legal reform. And Professor Martin Flaherty from Fordham is also the founder and leader of the Leitner Center for Human Rights at Fordham, and has been not just a leading academic in this field, but also an activist in the human rights advocacy in many countries, including China, and is one of the founding members and leaders of the committee to help Chinese lawyers. So we have an amazing panel here, and I'm looking forward to hearing what they have to say. Our topic, throughout the day today, we're going to be talking about human rights in China from different perspectives, and specifically how to have a positive influence to promote better human rights protection in China from different points of view, and from different vantage points. Now, in this panel, we're going to focus on perhaps the most powerful actor with the greatest potential to improve the human rights situation in China, and that's the Chinese government itself, and sometimes what we call the Chinese party state, because we have to, when we talk about China, we have to include not just the government, but the Chinese Communist Party, and I would say also the folks in China who are sometimes referred to as teacher name, people who are within the system, within the establishment, who influence policy within the Chinese government. One of China's great assets is its intellectual power, the number of people and the quality of the people who are studying these issues, researching them, writing, and advising the Chinese government. But before we can discuss how best to influence the Chinese party state, we have to examine where the current administration is on human rights. And that's not a simple task. When we visited China this past December with Dean Morrison, in doing our programs, we met with many of our colleagues who are legal experts in China. And I found that there was an excitement among legal academics, among the legal community in China, that I hadn't seen in almost 10 years, that all anybody could talk about was the third plenum decision. The third plenum of the 18th Party Congress, or the Party Congress that had just recently met and issued a decision that committed the party to reform in many different areas, including the rule of law and judicial reform. The party announced that re-education through labor, which has been the target of human rights advocates for many decades, would finally be abolished. That had been expected, but it was still a major accomplishment. And of course, people are now trying to examine what will take the place of re-education through labor. The party also announced that it was committing itself to centralizing power over courts and judges. And what that means is that the power to appoint judges and the power to set the budgets for courts would be taken away from local governments and brought up to the provincial level. It seems like a very technical reform, but it's one that is extremely difficult and could have very far-reaching effects. In essence, and we've heard about this reform for over a decade, but the party has committed itself to, and those folks in the legal community in China are very optimistic that this reform will take place. And this will allow courts to render decisions independently from the influence of local governments. Of course, courts will still be part of the Communist Party and government system, but since local governments are so involved in economic and social activity in their local areas, eliminating their influence on the courts is a very big deal. These reforms were very specific, and the announcements of these and other specific reforms also followed. The Supreme People's Court has announced that all decisions from Chinese courts will be published, will be made public, and that they expect to do this within a 3-year time period. So therefore, increasing the transparency of the work of the courts and making judges more accountable to the public. Also a very significant reform. Officials from as high as the Central Party Legal Committee, the Supreme People's Court, provincial high courts have all committed themselves to reforms to prevent wrongful convictions and to redress wrongful convictions, and we have seen a series of pronouncements from the highest levels of the Chinese court re-emphasizing that commitment. And we've seen many cases of innocent people having been convicted of serious crimes, having their convictions overturned, and they're being exonerated. We've also seen the court announce reforms to make the trial the centerpiece of criminal litigation as opposed to the criminal investigation. These are a few of the highlights of the reforms that have been announced by the government. I should say also, when we accompanied Dean Morrison to the Supreme People's Court, we saw a banner hanging over the court with the slogan of President Xi Jinping, saying that the people should feel justice and fairness in every case. And while we can be skeptical about the significance of slogans have their importance in China. So part of the reason Chinese legal scholars are excited about these announcements and these developments are because they're in such sharp contrast to the immediately preceding administration. And I think our colleague from Fordham, Carl Minsner, aptly described the previous administration's policy as a turn against law. Formal legal procedures were discouraged in favor of informal mediation and dispute resolution, and party loyalty was valued over legal professionalism. The slogan under the previous administration was the three supremes, that the party supreme, the people are supreme, and lastly, the law and the Constitution. So these positive reforms and policy statements I've just described are only part of a much more complex story. At the same time that all of these announcements and these new policies were being promulgated, we've also seen another set of policies promulgated and put into place. Back in the fall, the Supreme People's Court announced a series of judicial interpretations on the crimes of rumor mongering and criminal defamation on the internet. They threatened severe penalties for those people who publish commentary found to be offensive that are read by 5,000 people or more, or reposted by 500 or more. And the judicial interpretations have also come at the same time that prominent people who post on the internet on Chinese Weibo, the Chinese equivalent of Twitter, or on blogs, many of prominent people have been prosecuted. And some have even been brought on Chinese television in handcuffs to confess, even before they've been charged. Some prominent public intellectuals have stopped posting on Weibo, have taken down their blogs, and there's been a measurable effect on public discourse in China. And the Chinese government has prosecuted members of the loosely organized New Citizens Movement, including lawyer and law professor Xu Zhiyong, who appears to have done nothing more than to organize a group of petitioners to make their petitions at the same time so that they would get more attention for their petitions, and to hold up placards in public parks advocating that government officials disclose their financial assets, a policy that's very much in line with Chinese government's own anti-corruption campaign. So against this backdrop of seemingly contradictory policies on protecting human rights, I want to turn this over to the panel and ask them what they make of these developments and how they understand the current administration's commitment to human rights. I hope you'll address the question of what are some of the most effective ways of influencing the Chinese government, both to further protect human rights and to refrain from violating human rights. And I hope you'll also address the question of how much is possible in terms of improving human rights in China absent significant political reform. So our arrangement is each panelist will speak for 10 minutes, then I'll give everyone a chance to respond if they like to the other panelists, and then we'll open it up for questions and comments. Thank you. We'll start with Professor. We decided to use a neutral principle, so we're going in alphabetical order by last name, but Professor Flaherty as commentator will go last. So I'll ask Professor Baum to start.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm extremely happy to be here with you today. Very happy to see there are two ladies in the panel, and two European ladies, actually. I'm also very happy to see so many friends that I've only met in China, and some of them many years ago. So to all of you, good morning. I'm going to try in 10 minutes to respond to the two questions Professor Belkin I've just raised, which are extremely important and difficult questions. The first one being, how do we understand the gap between discourses and practices in terms of legal reform, judicial reforms, and human rights in China? And that's very difficult to understand. And the second one is, how can we address the question of human rights from where we are, us academic, from each country where we come from? The first point, and I'm going to leave a little bit the area of legal studies and do more political analysis of the Chinese government toward the question of human rights in China. And I think for me, one of the reasons why there is such a gap between discourses and practices, first of all, it's because of political reasons. Secondly, it's because I think, to me, the legal system in China is still very ineffective. Thirdly, there are new actors and many new tensions in China. And these new actors within the political system of China may not be people who are very in favor of developing constitutionalism and human rights. First point, the political reasons. I think since the beginning of the reform era, the progresses in terms of human rights in China have always been very chaotic. It was not a linear process. It was made of stop and goes. We know where China comes from. It's a post-Maoist regime, but we don't know where China is going to. There is not a clear, you know, agenda which says that the Chinese government, you know, considers that it's going to establish a rule of law. So we tend to assume that China is in a transition process. So we always measure the gap between where is China now and what is a rule of law. But actually my sense, from having staying in China for quite some years, my sense is there is not such a transition. It's a transformation within the exact same system as the one that existed at the end of the Cultural Revolution. Secondly, I think there is at least a minimum consensus, which is that there is a need to control the society, to control the stability of the society. Some groups within the political system consider that a type of governance between rule by law and a conservative sense of rule of law is a good idea, is possible. But and I think most of the people within the Jijine, within the system, consider that less injustice means a better governance, and they agree on that. But it doesn't mean that the agenda is constitutionalism, rule of law. And I think we can see that, you know, every 5 years, all the time. And the last crisis we have to face was last year, after the third plenum. You might remember the censored editorial of the Nanfang Zhenmo in January, which was very important. My sense is human rights is accepted when it means a better governance, but when it means political reform, it's not accepted, and this is still the case. The second point is really what I wanted to make, is the legal system in China, to put it very simply, is still a very ineffective legal system. We believe that the NPC is a parliament. We see the National People's Congress as a regular parliament. Actually, it's not a parliament. And I've done some work and that I would like to show you. I would like to show you three slides to make my point clear. Let me see how it works. Is it like that? Oh, yeah, you have it already? Okay, so if you have a quick look at this first slide, I wanted to show you. We've made a research trying to see what actually was if legal activity of the NPC, the Standing Committee of the NPC and the State Council. And what you can see on this graph, we try to map the legal activities of all these three authorities. And you realize that actually laws in China, there are very, very few laws in China for a country of this size. Below the law, you have, you know, thousands and thousands of administrative regulations. That would be fine enough, but if you look into details, actually, these regulations, they have many different types of names. There is no hierarchy in between these norms, and it's a completely chaotic. So basically, what you see in the middle of the map is 通知, notice, China is ruled by notices, and sometimes resolutions, ordinances, decisions, measures, provisions, and very, very few law. All of them are completely incompatible between each other. And knowing that there is no judicial review, or you call it constitutional review, you really understand that actually there is a very ineffective legal system. First plus, secondly, there are two institutions which make the legal system in China. It's the Legislative Affairs Commission within the Standing Committee of the NPC, and a bureau, the Legislative Affairs Bureau within the State Council. They compete within each other, and this competition sometimes means a lot of political tensions. Another important thing I'd like to show you, and does that work like this? No. I need your help, Judy. How do I put the next? Do you mind to help me? Merci. Thank you. A very important thing. I mentioned there are new actors within this system. And to put it very simply, I will call it the public security. If you have a look to this graph, again, it's a work we have done by combining all the important laws enacted by the NPC and Standing Committee of the NPC from 78 to last year. And you see on this graph many different colors. I'm not going to explain in detail. The only thing you need for the purpose of this presentation to look at is a blue part, which means public security. And what I mean by public security is a number of laws which deals with censorship, anti-terrorism, regulations on internet, regulations on Weiwen, on protecting the stability of the society. And you see that it started around 2005, a few years before the Olympic Games. Then it was extremely important. It expanded during the Olympic Games, and it continues up to last year. So basically, all these regulations which aim at controlling the society to make sure the society is stable, they're basically because of two effects. First of all, internet has completely changed China's society, and the regulation on internet, in order to censor it, has expanded. Secondly, the increasing importance of the Ministry of Public Security before, during, and after the Olympic Games have completely transformed and reshaped the political discourse within the Chinese government and the CCP on the question of human rights. This is something we underline very much, but it is actually extremely important. We tend to consider China's political system as a triangle, the state, the party, and the army, but we definitely forgot that there is now a fourth increasing power, which is the Ministry of Public Security. And the point I would like to make here is one of the reasons why there is such a gap between practices and discourses is because the tensions within the party on these very important issues are extremely important. There is not one single voice on these issues. And I believe, and that's the next slide, Judy, if possible, you could help me. And I believe these tensions are going to increase if you look at the fact, and that's Mr. Cheng Li, who has published these data, not me. Mr. Cheng Li has shown that among the full members of the Central Committee trained in law, you have an increasing number of people trained in law. You can see the evolution from 1997 to the last Congress in 2012. So there is a growing number of people within the CCP, including at the top level, the Central Committee, who've studied law, who consider themselves as, easy legal professionals because they are lawyers, but they are really professional in the matter of law. And they have to compete with people who have nothing, have absolutely no knowledge on law. And what is true for the Central Committee is true for many other ministries, and it's definitely true within the NPC itself. So what we can, the tensions we are, we observe currently is these tensions are going to increase very much. Because I only had a few minutes, I wanted just to make sure that actually I could send some messages. The most important messages I wanted to make is definitely there are reforms on the judicial reforms, because judicial reforms are seen as governance reforms. It's not so much generally speaking, not too much debated because related to human rights. And the new debate on the centralization of the judicial system is very much in tune with this idea that transforming the judiciary for better governance in China is okay. There's quite a big consensus. Now, in terms of really changing the law itself because of the inefficiency of the legal systems, but because also of the fact that there are many people trained in law, these tensions are going to increase very much. And if I have one last minute, I should respond to the second question, what can we do? How do we address these questions? I believe as an European, it's a little bit different because I guess, and it's different from an academic perspective and from a country perspective. If I want to say, for me, the first question is how do we address that? Because our economies are very interdependent between China and the rest of the world. You might have seen that President Xi Jinping's last week visited Europe, and the big question was, just like, exactly like here, what should we do? Do we have to sign contract? Yes, we do. We are facing a huge economic crisis, but do we have to also raise a question of human rights? Yes, we do, but how do we do it? So usually, my sense is in Europe, there is a division of labor. Governments don't talk too much officially about human rights. They let us do it. They let us do it by long-term cooperation programs, or they let NGOs do that. Now you have two types of NGO, I would say, in Europe. One want to work hand-in-hand with China, including China NGOs, and their main goal is to try not to isolate the people within China who are open-minded, want to work on these issues, and need the help of the outside world. Another type of NGOs who have a strong advocacy and like Reporters Without Borders, who, like last week in Europe, do launch campaigns which are very aggressive campaigns, and sometimes I doubt that it can be used by the people within China because it's so much aggressively against the Chinese government that it might be very hard for them to identify to these campaigns. Also, I want to say that for me, we first need to explain to our Chinese partners that it's rational. I mean, human rights, beside the question that in terms of value, it's so much importance to each of us, and it's so much an important universal value. From a rational point of view, more human rights is also good for China's governance. And also by using, you know, the mindset of the Chinese government and with this obsession of the social stability, if we can explain that, you know, protection of human rights and less injustice is really good also for the stability of the country, we might also be heard more. Another point is we need to engage China not only on human rights, but another very important issue which are actually related to human rights. We need to engage China on environmental issues, development of Africa, immigration issues, intellectual property rights, censorship on internet. All these issues, usually we don't exactly know what the Chinese government, you know, think about all these issues. But by engaging them on these issues, then we also can, you know, raise the question of human rights. And much more, I'm sorry, but I think my time is running out. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Stéphanie, for that amazing presentation. I don't know how you packed so much information into 10 minutes. And you stimulated a lot of questions in my mind, and I'm sure in the minds of the audience, which I hope we'll get to during the comment section, especially prominent to the first part of your presentation is whether this new administration under Xi Jinping represents a break or a change from all of the focus on social stability. And I hope we'll get to discuss that more during the comments. Next, we have Professor Fu Hualing from Hong Kong, who, as I said before, has written on many of these issues, maybe all of them, in the past, and has a incredible perspective, having grown up in China and lived in Hong Kong many years and studied abroad. And his perspective really bridges the world inside China and how the outside world also looks at China. So, President Fu, Professor Fu, if only you were president.
Thank you for your promotion. Thank you for the invitation. Very happy to be back again to talk to you on human rights in China. Judicial protection of human rights is extremely important. In order to have effective judicial protection of human rights, you must have a judiciary that is independent, effective. So what I'm going to do in my 10 minutes is to outline the current judiciary reform, to understand the motivation, and then try to answer some of the specific questions that are posed to us. In the past 4 weeks, quite a few state leaders went to Shenzhen. The most recent one is Meng Jianzhu, who is the chairman of the party's political legal committee. Before, excuse me, before him was the Guangdong's provincial party chief, Fu Chunhua, who went to Shenzhen for 5 days. 2 weeks before Fu Chunhua was the Chief Justice Zhou Qiang, who also spent a week in Shenzhen. The only reason they all went to Shenzhen for quite extensive period of time was to iron out some pilot judicial program. They announced the reform more than a year ago, but nothing has happened so far. So I think they all get a bit worried as to how to just answer the questions to the central committees. So what they are doing is basically to renew the judiciary reform, which was abandoned in 2003, and to continue with whatever Xiaoyang, the earlier Chief Justice, was not able to complete. So what they did immediately is to send a reform proposal, which was sent to the Communist Party in 2003 and was rejected. And this time, they accepted the old, it's a 10-year-old reform proposal, and started the pilots in Shenzhen's courts. So there are a few dimensions in the reform proposal. What is ongoing in the one of the district court in Fudian is to create a 1-2-3-4 structure. That's always Chinese way to think about reform is a number, right? One chief judge, 2 assistant judge, 3 judicial supporting staff, 4 administrative staff, right? So you organize one team, and then you would handle cases within those teams. Right? You will be financially independent, and you will be relatively independent in the decision-making process, with the chief judge being the person accountable to the president of the court. In the Hutian's pilot experience, each team would be responsible for about 900 cases per year. If you finish the cases, then of course you get the regular annual bonus, you get the promotion that you deserve. What is essential in that reform is to give the chief judge the responsibility. You don't have to report to your Tingzang. You don't have to report to the VP of the president. So somehow of the court, somehow there's a larger degree of autonomy in the decision-making process, and of course, and the corresponding responsibilities that the judges would have to bear. So that is the what they are doing at the ground level. The second dimension, which Aaron has mentioned, is to centralizing the budget at the provincial level. Meng Jianzhu has said in public that China is a unitary state. Legal institutions are central power, meaning that all the courts should have been paid for by the central budget. But unfortunately, China is currently in such a circumstances that the central government is not able to pay for the judges in China. Therefore, as a compromise, it has to delegate the province, the provincial government, to pay the judges at the provincial level. There are lots of rhetorics. Surprisingly, judges are not really happy about that. I thought judges would be very happy if they're paid for not by the local governments, but by the higher level government. But actually, lots of judges don't like ideas, especially judges from rich cities. If they're paid for by their local government, their incomes will be more stable and higher. Now, if they're taken over by the provincial government, it will average out, so their salary may be adversely affected. So there's the dilemma. The third item in the reform is, I think it's the most important one, is to create a separate judicial track in personnel management. In Shenzhen, what they're doing now is on the table, they are discussing with the Communist Party's organization department, is to do away the administrative rank in the court. So in the future, in Shenzhen and later in Guangdong, you will have a separate civil service structure for the judges and the prosecutors only. You will not have a tinzang, tuzang anymore. You only have senior judges, grade one, grade two, grade three, and the judges 1, 2, 3. And then your payment and the benefits and the retirement benefit all linked to your judicial rank. They do that mainly because that would give more space for the judges at the junior level, especially at the district level, more possibility to be promoted. Right? Under the current structure, the promotion is extremely difficult. The opening up or the creation of a separate judicial track would be very beneficial for the judges, especially judges at the district level. The final reform, which is also significant, is to limit the extrajudicial petition. Carl is here, who is the authority on petition in China. The main message is, if a case is sub judice, or if a case has gone through the court, the petition bureau is not expected to touch those cases anymore. So the issue is you have to persuade the people to go back to the court to accept the finality of a court decision. And of course, the interesting issue is whether that is possible. Where are the incentives? The people who go to Beijing for petition, why they are not going to Beijing? So that is the issue I need to speed up. So what's the reason? Well, because reading through the proposals, you have a strong sense that there's a degree of urgency, if not crisis, in the mind of the Communist Party senior leaders. They are basically saying that it's very late. If we don't reform the court system now, we'll never have a chance to reform our court system. So we have to start now and immediately. It appears as a top-down reform, but actually is made in response to the bottom-up social pressures. So what are the pressures? Well, first, the pressures from judges. In the past 3 years, from 2008 and 2010, almost 9,000 judges quit the courts, especially in the coastal cities. In Guangdong, the number was, the Guangdong is 16,000 during 2 and 3 years. In Jiangsu was almost 1,900, right? In Shenzhen, for example, in 10 years between 2003 and 2013, 16% of judges quit. They simply left and joined the legal profession or other government. So the Supreme People's Court was actually carrying those figures to the Communist Party, saying that if you don't do anything, we will not have a court to run in the long term. So that is the one pressure from the institution, from the judges, from the court. Second are the petitioners. And the petition system is destroying the Chinese judicial system. Right? And it opens up the whole system to political intervention. Courts cannot really run the judicial system with the petitioning system existing on the side. And finally, there are lawyers which are fighting very aggressively for fairness in the judicial process. I think largely the reform is ongoing now, the renewed reform process, because of the outside pressures. It's not from the inside of government which thinks we want to reform, but really they're responding to the bottom-up challenges. 1 minute, answer the one of the questions which is directly asked by the chairman, is it possible to improve human rights in China without changing the Communist Party, right? I guess the answer is yes, of course it's possible. I think what I want to say is this 4.3, yes, it is possible as long as civil society pushes the reform persistently, aggressively, proactively, and in a very organized way, right? That's the first point. Second point, how much rights of freedom people will enjoy very much depends on how hard are you going to fight for it. The rights are not going to be given to you unless you fight for it. And third point is, well, they're both bad news and good news. The bad news is China will be a very different place now if we have 1,000 museums. But unfortunately, we don't. There's only one. And most of the people would not really participate unless their own interests are adversely affected. No government official would support lawyers until they are arrested, detained for corruption. Then they think lawyers are wonderful people. But then at that point, it's a bit too late. But the good news, I think probably Eva is going to touch on, is we do have a new generation of lawyers, especially lawyers from graduating from elite law schools who are actively participating in public interest work. That is amazing to see the young generation of lawyers coming to the front, replacing the old guards. And finally, I want to make the point that we may have to go beyond the political system. On occasion, rights are violated because of the Communist Party, but on many other occasions, rights are violated in spite of the Communist parties. You have to look at the socioeconomic structures to understand why rights and freedom are violated. I think I should stop here. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Fu. I may call you President Fu from now on. I feel as though we've gotten a very inside look behind the curtain of judicial reforms in China, and you've given us a real flavor for the seriousness of the reforms in the judicial system, which I only touched upon in my comments, and a sense that this administration views the judiciary quite differently than the previous administration. I hope we'll explore that more in the comment period. So next I want to turn to Professor Eva Pills from Hong Kong.
Thank you very much. Thanks for the invitation. It's fantastic to be back here. And so I will make a few comments that I think will come across as a bit skeptical about the potential of what has been characterized, I think, very appropriately as the system, the establishment, the Qi Zhinei forces to promote human rights in China in a significant way. And then I also want to say a bit about how, in my view, we should view the relationship between the establishment, the party state, and rising political opposition and rising civil society forces in China. So I think from my perspective, and this perhaps is not so different from what Stéphanie and Hualing have said, the authorities indeed, I think the best way to understand what the party state is doing is by reference to this idea of regime stability. That, of course, internally in China is often called social stability, and to this phrase of "维稳压倒一切," of that stability trumps everything. I think that's what's been motivating a lot of reforms in recent years, and also the most recent reforms that we have been discussing here. And I think that so far as stability of the existing system is concerned, all other goals are subordinated to that, and that certainly, in my view, includes the protection of human rights. Much of the reforms that have been described in such detail and with so much insight just now, I think, can be understood as a way of centralizing control over the judiciary. I am skeptical about the ability, about the assessment that they make the judiciary significantly more independent. If we think about these recent reforms, judicial reforms, I think that they show that there is a commitment to improving the, what perhaps you could call the technical correctness of the judicial process. Injustice is unattractive. Wrongful convictions, wrong decisions are certainly what the central authorities don't want. But does that mean that they want more protection of human rights, that they are sincerely committed to that goal? I think, I'm afraid, there's a lot suggesting that there isn't such a, since that's such a clear commitment to effective reforms promoting human rights. And if you take, for instance, as an example, the introduction of the exclusionary rule in the criminal process, I think it's a very good way of looking at what is happening. The exclusionary rule was the rule excluding illegally obtained evidence in the criminal process was introduced in order to strengthen the ability, in order to, I think, if possible, avoid wrongful convictions. But when you look at how it is actually used in the criminal process in the past months and years, well, the lawyers, the criminal defense lawyers I've been talking to, generally report, and everything we know, I think, generally suggests that it is extremely difficult to use that rule in trial processes, that generally speaking, there has to be a huge effort even to persuade judges to look at that rule, and that even where the argument that defendants have been tortured, which unfortunately still happens a lot, can be made, the outcome of the trial is can be quite unfair. There can be still a conviction, perhaps with a reduced punishment of a defendant who has been tortured. Judges will, in the kinds of trials that we get to hear about often, actually say to lawyers, although of course only privately, you know that I can't do anything about this case. And I think that if we look at the reforms that have been introduced, they are simply not sufficient to make judges more independent. For one thing, just one thing, the assessment, the annual assessment of judges that is so decisive for their professional careers, their advancement, and their salaries and bonuses and so on, it continues to be maintained, and that means that each judge faces a lot of potential pressure when they are submitted to an assessment by their superiors about their performance in the adjudicative process. There is, of course, a lot of, and I think in the same context, officials, what officials have to fear increasingly now under the current leadership is the anti-corruption campaigns, which of course, in one sense, pursue a desirable goal, but which can also be used to purge those elements in the system that are not loyal, that are not loyal to the leadership. So I think that in addition to that, we observe, I think, comparing to the previous leadership, to the previous period, that essentially the security apparatus that was built up under Zhou Yongkang has been, of course, damaged by the removal of Zhou Yongkang. in one sense, but it does remain in place. Its methods remain in place. The people working in it are still there, and the various systems that have been established to control civil society through surveillance, through the famous chats, invitations to tea, through lots of measures within and, with and outside the legal system, including detentions, forced disappearances and torture, all of those measures remain in place and they continue to be used by the system to control rights advocates and other undesirable elements in civil society. So I'm quite skeptical that as long as these things remain in place, these very limited institutional reforms will be successful in significantly promoting the protection of human rights in China. And of course, part of my skepticism is also motivated by the fact that the new leadership, so far as I can see, has not really significantly changed its rhetoric. The turn to a neo-Maoist vocabulary that was started in the last administration has simply continued, and it is, after all, under Xi Jinping that the idea of the new Mao line and similar notions have been reintroduced into political discourse in Chinese society. I think that this is a return to an older style way, form of governance, far more centralized control, along with, as Ira, of course, mentioned, more control of public opinion, of the media, forming public opinion, as the phrase is, and controlling it. And ultimately far less room for civil society. What I find fascinating, and I realize that I should not take too much time to talk about it now, but what I find fascinating is that we have, on the one hand, this trend towards more control, more centralized control, and more repression, also within the official apparatus, within the TJU. But on the other hand, I think we have a very rapid rise of civil society. And perhaps a movement in the very recent months towards a kind of permeation of what we tend to think of as TJNA forces, as the establishment by civil society groups and ideas that used to be quite alien to the style of governance of the Chinese Communist Party. So one way of illustrating this trend would perhaps be by looking at the role of lawyers in the legal process. And of course, they are very important in any country to effective protection of human rights. I think that what we can see is that even as lawyers are more suppressed, many of us, I'm sure, are aware that as we speak, there is an ongoing case in a small place in Heilongjiang where a group of lawyers, four lawyers, went to try to come to help their illegally, extra-legally detained clients who promptly ended up being detained themselves, which triggered dispatches of more lawyers to the same location, who then also got detained, some got beaten, and so on and so forth. But even as this repression appears to be increasing, we see very unfortunately, I think, more brute violence being used against human rights defenders and human rights lawyers. We can also, I think somewhat surprisingly, see that nevertheless these groups are actually rising in numbers, and they're certainly increasing their ability to make appeals directly to Chinese society. And the most important tool for that, of course, is certainly the internet. And coming back to what I just said about relationship between TJNA, TJY, the systems inside and outside the system. I think that what we can also see is that within the legal profession, to say with this example, there is an increasing readiness of professional colleagues who used to be part of the establishment, who used not to be provocative, not to irritate the authorities, to see what is happening to their professional colleagues, to be moved by that and to join these forces. And that's probably the only way to explain why groups of human rights lawyers that used to comprise only a handful of individuals are numbering around 100 to 200 individuals, which I think is an illustration of the importance of rising civil society in China. So the one last thing that I want to say is that I think we have to be aware of this development, and I would very much suggest that we should not fall into the, we should avoid the risk of being co-opted, be it and mentally or in sort of in terms of what we actually do, by the promises of top-down reform and collaboration with exclusively with the Qijine forces, with exclusively with the establishment. I think we must all pay attention to, and I think we also should support the forces outside the establishment, people in civil society who are trying to promote human rights in China. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Pills. I think from these first three presentations, we've gotten a very nuanced, kind of multi-layered look at what's happening in China today, and the picture is much more complex than you get from probably any other source. And I want to turn to Professor Flaherty for his comments on the presentations and his own thoughts.
So I'm trying to make sense of all of this in 10 minutes. Well, first of all, Ira, thank you very much. Thanks to you in particular. Thanks to NYU and the USALI, and thanks to Jerry Cohen, of course. Ira's far too kind. I do not hold myself out as in any way a China expert. I view myself as a human rights generalist who, over the past, 10, 15 years has tried to educate myself on China. So I've taught in China. I've done a surreptitious human rights mission with at least one member of this panel. And for the last 10 years, I've taught at Princeton a seminar on promoting the rule of law in China. I see some of my current and former students. My wife's also Chinese, so that doesn't hurt. And it's in, and one thing I want to say in terms of bringing that background to this subject is, as a generalist, I think it's a sad truth that China tends to be under-scrutinized by the mainstream human rights movement, notwithstanding HRIC and notwithstanding a signal exception is Human Rights Watch. I see Sophie there. But there are some major NGOs that don't do anything at all about China. And I think that the mainstream human rights movement just doesn't attend to China as much as it should. And the reason it should is actually, I'm reminded of something Bob Bernstein, who I saw come in, said when he and Jerry and a few others were founding a group that I'm associated with, the Committee to Support Chinese Lawyers. And it's an obvious truth, but it's one that bears repeating, which is that when it comes to impact on human rights, and this is one reason why this panel is so critical, there is no government in the world that is more important or can affect more people with regard to its policies concerning human rights than the People's Republic of China. So all of that is to say, in one sense, that human rights in China is something that is too important to be left merely to just the China experts, that there should be more people who are non-China experts who are listening to what's going on here. Why? Because without the wisdom and without the experience of the people who really are truly knowledgeable about China, it is just going to be impossible for the entire human rights movement to, I think, make a difference. And that's why I think the work of the USALI and the conception of today is so important and so valuable. And I know that I've already learned a tremendous amount. So to address some of the themes we've seen today, I want to pick up the metaphor that my colleague Carl Minzner introduced into the discourse that Ira referred to, which was that at least since the turn of the millennium, and certainly even more so after the Olympics, that under the previous administration, there was a turn away from the law, a turn against the law. And really, the question we're addressing is, where under Xi Jinping are we turning now? And there are at least three possibilities. One is that what we see is really more of the same, that all of the reforms and rhetoric that a lot of people are so excited about really are just so much window dressing. I actually don't think that, but that's certainly one possibility. Another possibility is that what we see is actually the beginnings of some kind of genuine reform, and that to the extent there are contradictory signals like crackdown on lawyers, that what that really is Xi Jinping fainting right to move left, ultimately. A thesis, however, that I've been playing around with, and in to a great extent, I think a lot of what the panelists have said, at least to me, tends to support it, but I'd be interested to hear, obviously, what they say and what all of you have to say, is that really what's going on here is an effort to reform for the following model, and the following model would be a vision that China would be Singapore writ large. Okay, and that, and what does that mean? Well, at the very least, it means there will be relatively uncorrupt rule of law, certainly for business, okay? And beyond that, what would it mean? And beyond that, what it would mean, I would submit, is something I would call a thin version of the rule of law. This is something that arose out of this seminar. So there are at least three ways, among many others, that you could define rule of law. One is an absolute de minimis conception, which is that law will be neutrally applied relatively uncorruptly, but that fundamental human rights, such as those enshrined in the Universal Declaration and the ICCPR, will not be addressed, and still less anything like democratic self-government. At the other end of the spectrum is precisely that. The thickest version of the rule of law would be neutral application of the law relatively uncorruptly, fundamental rights, to an extent, and then finally, democratic self-government and a free market economy. I think that the best we can shoot for under, to answer Ira's question, under the CCP is to move towards something like an intermediate form of the rule of law, but I'm not sure that's what's going on here. I think that what is going on here is that the current leadership in many ways view Singapore as a model and envisions the rule of law as a mechanism for maintaining economic prosperity and growth and also for maintaining social stability. Now, that's obviously problematic from the point of view of many people sitting here. From the point of view of a human rights advocate, that is insufficient on its face. The question also arises, is it sustainable in a country as large as China, given the internet, given the growth of civil society that we've talked about? In other words, will something break ultimately? Now, the one thing I would say, though, is everything I've heard today, and maybe you hear what you want to hear, seems to be consistent with that model. Stephanie's remarks about, the continued insistence on social stability seem consistent with a Singapore writ large model. It strikes me that, even judicial reform, if it takes hold, is consistent with that, because moving beyond a business model, having a relatively uncorrupt judiciary that's independent, that will fight against pathologies like wrongful convictions, still falls far short of freedom of speech, of criticism of the government, et cetera. And needless to say, what Eva's talking about, and there are many more recent examples of crackdowns on lawyers, not to say the recent death and detention of Chao Shun-li and the behavior of the Chinese government at the Human Rights Council. All of that is certainly consistent with this idea that we will have a very, very de minimis sense of the rule of law, perhaps with some thin elements added on. So that's my working hypothesis. I'd love to hear a critique of that. Now, given that, the question is what to do. And just a few quick remarks on that. I think what a lot of folks in the human rights community have attempted to further, and I sense this in some of Stephanie's remark, is what I call the Trojan horse approach, which is engagement on non-threatening rule of law issues with the hope that that will then spill over to protection of fundamental rights by the courts to some version of judicial review, et cetera, et cetera. And in fact, you know, in this seminar I teach, that's often what my students usually have to present before the DRL at the State Department. That's often what the students themselves come to. You have to present non-threatening forms of legal engagement. An example we came up with was the Ministry of Environment and the EPA actually have been working on many joint projects to enhance administrative law in China to enforce environmental regulations. That is something that the party looks favorably on, but it also introduces, you know, concepts of administrative law and the rule of law. So I'm almost out of time. Now, that should always be discounted by sharp advocacy when lawyers and other dissidents are under threat. The question is, will it be effective, especially, and will it feed into a Singapore model unless we're a little bit more aggressive about the human rights aspects? And for that reason, I think that, among other things, a focus on lawyers and judicial independence is very important, because that is a key pressure point where you might get further spillover into some of these other aspects of the law. But since I'm out of time, I just wanted to put those thoughts out there, and I look very much forward to what the panelists have to say and what you all have to say.
Thank you, Professor Flaherty. You know, in the introduction, I remarked on what a great panel we have, and I think my comments have been vindicated, but I didn't remark on what a great audience we have. We have, I have a lot of things I want to say and a lot of questions, but I've already taken up some time. I want to give you a chance to ask questions and make comments. So, Ling and Alvin, Professor Anasio, let's start with those three. Oh, I'm sorry. And we'll see if we have time to get to the other comments. I also have to say, correct a omission, a terrible omission I made in my comments, and that is I failed to thank the Bernstein family, especially my classmate Bill Bernstein, for supporting this conference. Without their help and support, we couldn't have this conference at all. So I apologize for the omission and just want to express my gratitude to them.
Okay, first of all, it's very exciting panel. Thank you all for your exciting presentations. Especially, it's a chance for me to see Stéphanie, Ava, Hualing, who I only got to see back in China or in Europe years ago. So I have two questions. One goes to Stéphanie, one goes to Professor Fu. For Stéphanie, I'm very interested that you raised the observation of the rise of public security in the party state. I know Carl has written with Wang Yunhua from UPenn a wonderful paper about the political public security, the Zhengfa way, their structure, their membership, which indicated, well, usually we link the rise of public security to the appointment of Zhou Yongkang as the to the Politburo Standing Committee. But according to Wang Yuhua's research, the rise actually happened under the leadership of Ren Jianxin, who was actually the president of Supreme People's Court at that time. And when Zhou Yongkang took power, the trend actually goes down. So I'm wondering whether you would agree it's not an issue about the rise of public security, which means public security bureau is always important to the party, whether it's actually a question about the concentration of power over public security in one individual party leader. Sorry.
Okay, Ling, I think we have to limit one question to one person. If there's time, we'll come back. And I should have said earlier, please limit your comments and questions to just 1 minute if possible, so we can get as many people in the conversation as possible. And what I'm going to do is have these three questions first, and then we'll ask the panelists to respond. So, Alvin? And in 1 minute, please.
Thank you to all panelists, and thank you to the USA Law Institute, Human Rights Law Institute. longstanding policy was to hive off all of these uncontroversial disputes.
I hope that doesn't count against my time.
it does.
China's policy has been to hive off uncontroversial disputes to, for instance, SeaTac, and the idea was to free them from provincial influence. What we've seen now with the SeaTac split, that even SeaTac has been riven by factional rivalries, and as I understand it, the Supreme People's Court still hasn't ruled on the validity of the split subcommissions, and SeaTac was supposed to eliminate factional interests. So if that's what's happened to the flagship rule of law project on economic rights, what hope is there for the rest of us?
Okay, and the third question from Professor Anasio. And after this question, we'll ask the panel to respond. If there's time left, we'll take more questions and comments. Can we have this? Can we have this mic? We're usually about 50-50 with our mics working.
But most people don't think I really need a microphone because my voice is so. I want to take issue with the Singapore idea. It's very interesting, but it belies the trends, right? I mean, a lot of power, if anything, power has tended to be decentralized, and a lot more power has flowed into the provinces and the local government. In fact, you see some of the trend of what's happening in the courts and such. And especially the court's power being decentralized is big, right? There are very few countries of the world where the courts are appointed not by the center. The United States and China being two of the few. And so I think that idea. But what I really wonder is, besides it sort of having some empirical difficulties, can a country the size of China operate on a model like Singapore? It seems to me totally impossible.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, I agree.
Okay, so let's take these. I mean, let's take these in order. I think the first question was for Stéphanie, for Professor Baum. I'm not sure, Alvin, if you had a specific panelist in mind for your question.
Professor Baum and Flaherty.
Okay, and then the last one for Professor Flaherty. So, Stéphanie.
Okay, so I'd like to respond to 3 points, 15 seconds each, try my best. First of all, on the public security, it means budget, human resources, ideology, and it's a very long process. And what we've seen in, coming before the Olympics was just the coming out of a process that arrived, that started much, much before. So what we need to know, and it's extremely difficult as a researcher, is to know what is the agenda, the ideological agenda of a public security. And to link into the point you made, I don't think we're so much into a Singaporean model, but I'm afraid that if we, things don't go better, we might have a Putin's Russia type of system, And so the last point I want to make is about centralization of power. There is, it's extremely difficult. There is a difficult point when you look at China, and you think in terms of political reforms. The centralization process in China, we find it means modernization. For example, centralizing the judiciary, it's a way for judges to get more independence. But usually, democratization comes with decentralization. So there is this really big tension in Chinese political system, which the more you centralize, the more there is a risk that the centralization process prevents from the democratization process.
I just want to add a couple of comments. I think one of the things that we're seeing with judicial reform, and it started, I think, with the appointment of Zhou Tiang, who was legally trained, well-regarded legal scholar to head the Supreme People's Court, as opposed to his predecessor, who had no legal training, but a lot of experience in the party. And from what some of the reforms that we've described, especially the details that Professor Fu Hualing has added, we see that this administration's response to a lack of trust or lack of public trust or confidence in the courts, I think is the exact opposite of the response of the previous administration. The previous administration wanted to promote mediation, wanted to devalue formal court procedures, wanted to get away. They didn't believe in the rule of law or the courts. And what we see, whether you think these reforms go far enough or don't go far enough or the right formula or not, what we see is a great effort to make the courts meaningful and to shore up public trust and confidence in the courts by reforming the courts themselves. We don't know whether it will work or not, but I think this is palpable. How much this is related personally to Zhou Yongkang, he certainly got a lot of the blame for what happened in the past administration. And we immediately saw that his position as chair of the Political Legal Committee was demoted to not be part of the Standing Committee, and we've just seen a lot of effort. So I just point these out again, just to comments. I would also say in response to Stephanie's last point, the lack of rule of law or the weak rule of law and weak human rights protection gives local governments greater opportunities for abuse. And we've just seen this in many cases. I was struck by Professor Fu's comment that sometimes human rights violations happen in spite of the party, not because of them. And one of the features of life in China that we've seen over the past decades is the lack of adherence to even central government policy by local governments. Just in response to Stephanie's point, the point about more democracy and more participation and better human rights protection, it's not clear if it's better to have central government control or local government control. I think in this instance, there's a positive aspect of more central government control. I'm just going to interrupt the order to give Professor Cohen a chance to respond. I was wondering
why... This has been a terrific discussion, and I think as we make a transition to the second panel, the concept of struggle, Dojung, is useful here. I agree the leaders would love the Singapore model, but I agree China isn't Singapore, and there's an ongoing struggle at the central level. Is there really going to be a rule of law? Is the party going to let the central judiciary have independence? No. But there's also a struggle, not only at the central level, but also between the center and the localities. And this is an ongoing struggle. And you have, in addition to the party and the officialdom, you have what we're going to consider now, the NGOs, we have the lawyers, and there's an ongoing struggle, and we are a very minor part of it, but we're not irrelevant, as we will hear perhaps this afternoon. But I think this concept of it's fluid, it's up for grabs. We don't know what will happen. Progress is certainly being made toward a regularization of the legal system. On the other hand, every day we see blatant violations. And the only final point I want to make is the continuing non-transparency. Despite all the progress IRA and others have pointed out, the fact is, what is the relationship today at the central level and the local level between the political legal people, the party people, and the official legal people who are also party members? What's really happening in the adjudication of individual cases? We still don't know, and we may see that, as in many other things, there are different things going on in different cities and different provinces. I've been struck when I've been out in the West in China how different their criminal justice has been on occasion from criminal justice in the coastal cities. So this is a fascinating ongoing process, but I think the speakers have really done justice to it, and I certainly look forward to hearing the next round.
Well, I can't think of a better note on which to close this panel. We're also happened to be a little bit over time, but we started late. But to keep us more or less on schedule, I'm just going to stop here and again thank our panelists. Encourage you to continue the conversation over the coffee break. Thank you.